I'm Justin. Today we're in Savannah, Georgia. It's October 9th, and we're commemorating the anniversary of the Revolutionary War Battle of Savannah on this episode of History Where It Happened. The 1779 Battle of Savannah was one of the costliest encounters for the American colonists and their international allies, particularly the French, led by Count Charles-Henri d'Estaing. After the fighting, d'Estaing wrote that the battle only lasted an hour and was very violent. British General Prevost estimated that the British soldiers had lost about 55 men, compared to a staggering number of between 1,000 and 1,200 for the Americans and their allies. Later counts will bring this total down closer to about 800, but still, the battle here in Savannah has been described as the second costliest battle of the entire Revolution and the bloodiest hour of fighting for the whole Revolutionary War. Whew. Wow, that looks dangerous. You know, when you think about a historic battlefield, this is probably what you picture. A replica fort, nice open green space, some informational signage. While the majority of the Battle of Savannah was fought here at the Spring Hill Redoubt, there were battle operations scattered all over the city, and it hasn't all been this well preserved. Why don't we go take a look? The scene here looked a little bit different in the fall of 1779. The French Navy began to arrive in the waters around Savannah around September 11th, mostly to the south of the city. Now, unfortunately, they weren't able to make much progress to the north of the city, up the Savannah River that had been blocked by the British Navy. After the French arrived, the British politely declined to surrender the city, and the French began to prepare for their attack, offloading guns near here at Thunderbolt. Coastal residents know exactly how hard it is to get out of town during a hurricane evacuation. And unloading cannons into the marshes around Thunderbolt isn't exactly the same as dealing with traffic on I-95, but it's not easy work either. Constant heavy rains slowed down the French, delayed their movements, and made it harder for them to get their cannons into positions. On October 3rd, they were finally able to begin their attack on the city, but they couldn't quite aim. Instead of weakening the British defenses around Savannah, they perforated the homes and buildings throughout the town. After almost a week of attack, d'Estaing was getting nervous that the weather would get worse with his entire fleet off of the coast near Tybee. So he called off the bombardment and made plans for a ground assault the next day. The attack was scheduled to begin the next morning at dawn, with the men marching up or parallel to what is now Louisville Road. Louisville Road? Louisville Road? I don't know. But a tropical storm of confusion rained down on the men as they began their attack. Soldiers got lost in the swamps surrounding the city. Those swamps today, though, have been replaced by this drainage canal and student housing. Today, Louisville Road shows more signs of Savannah's railroad past than of its Revolutionary War history. Sites like this freight warehouse are scattered throughout the town. But on the morning of the battle, it might have been here that the Americans discovered they had faulty intelligence. You see, they were targeting the Spring Hill Redoubt because they thought that it was manned by militia. Militia that would get scared and run away at the first sign of fighting. Unfortunately, it was actually staffed by fearsome and battle-hardened regular soldiers. Soldiers who had a reputation for not taking prisoners and instead killing the wounded on the battlefield. And as the morning fog began to clear, the bright white French uniforms made easy targets for the skilled marksmen inside. The 500-yard charge across mostly open terrain was devastating for the French and American forces. Notable historical figures like William Jasper and Casimir Pulaski fell in Savannah. John Lawrence was present and commanding a regiment of American soldiers. Clearly, Lawrence failed to rise up on October 9th, but what happened after he threw his sword down in disgust after watching the attack fail? The land that was used to build this cemetery was actually a gift from King George III himself. It was granted to Mordecai Schefdahl in order to establish a Jewish community cemetery just a little bit south of the Schefdahl family cemetery. Today, it sits sandwiched between a local elementary school and interstate. On the morning of October 9, 1779, though, this proved to be a pivotal location for the battle for freedom from King George. A small group of French artillery and reserve soldiers were stationed here, waiting for their orders during the attack. In his battle plans, American General Benjamin Lincoln wrote that the Jewish cemetery would be the rallying point if his men failed to take the Spring Hill Redoubt. Unfortunately, there would be no rallying that morning. Of course, instead of returning here to the Jewish cemetery to gather their forces and attack again, after only an hour of fighting, the Americans and the French were in a full retreat. The Battle of Savannah was lost. The whole colony of Georgia would be the only colony to remain in British hands throughout the rest of the war. Americans would not take back Savannah until after the world turned upside down at Yorktown and the British surrendered the war once and for all. Maybe if they had been successful in taking the Spring Hill Redoubt just a little bit behind me, the war in Georgia would have been over a little bit sooner, and independence could have come even earlier.